our folks, for the most part, there is three major places that they are going to get in infections. And basically, what those three places are called is the three W's. The first one is wind. And wind refers to air, refers to your lungs. And what this would be is like URI, upper respiratory infection, pneumonia, bronchitis, things like that. The next one is water. So when you think of water, you think of urine. So this is UTI, urinary tract infection. And the third W is wound or skin. So if you've got a resident, like I said, and they're normally alert and oriented, or for some reason they're just not acting, and here again, this is the detective role, and they're just not acting right, or maybe they're combative, or whatever. Think of these three W's, wind, water, wound. And, you know, kind of ask them, you know, or you can hear them. If they're coughing and having trouble breathing, you know, you basically know that something may be in their lungs. And they can get stuff in their lungs really, really fast. How many of you, when you wake up in the morning, cough a couple times? Anybody? One does, two does, a couple of you do? You do? Okay. What you're doing is you are coughing out of your lungs irritants that have gotten into your lungs during the night. It's your body defenses. It's your immune system. Now, what would happen, you think, if you didn't have a good cough reflex and those things stayed in your lungs? They're going to grow, they're going to consolidate, and probably go into a bronchitis, a bronchiolitis, a pneumonia. So that's why a lot of times the elderly can get upper respiratory infections really quick, is because they can't cough this stuff out. Now, if you're ever taking care of your resident, and let's just say you're helping them on with their shirt, or you have your hand right here, like say you're checking their respirations. And when we do this for respirations, you know, I'll show you, you know, like a lot of times you can't see the chest rise and fall, so you just put your hand right here and feel your hand go up and down. Well, if you're ever touching the resident or like giving them a back rub or something like that, you got your hands on their chest somehow, and you feel a vibration through there, there's a real good chance what that means is they've got some kind of liquid, they've got some kind of fluid in their lungs. Because as air goes through water, it makes it vibrate. You can put your chest on your lungs, on your hand on your chest, and just take a deep breath. You feel anything? You shouldn't feel very much because your lungs are probably clear. But like I said, if you put your hand on there and you feel vibrations through that not all times, but sometimes that could mean something's in there, like maybe a consolidated area of pneumonia or a little bit of fluid buildup or a lot of fluid buildup. So that gives us warnings. The big fancy word for that is called phrenitis. Okay, wind, water, we've already talked about that a little bit. Water basically being urine, being bladder. Here again, your resident is confused. They're not coughing, you know. They're breathing okay. Well, it's probably not their lungs, but okay. When you urinate, George, does it burn? Oh man, yeah. I feel like I'm on fire. You know, and that could be the culprit. That could be the root problem of why they're confused. And the third one basically is wound. These are the three areas in long-term care that we are virtually working, struggling, being challenged with all the time to deal with in infections. Yeah.
Well, I've even noticed that the elderly sometimes don't even notice the burning urine.
Sometimes, yeah, their sensory system.
They can have pretty bad infections.
Yeah, and that's where, of course, then what we gotta do is, you know, when we talk about urine, you know, urine should be like amber yellow. And somebody starts getting a urinary infection, you're gonna see it change colors, you're gonna see cloudiness, you know, you're gonna see not the amber yellow, and you may, you know, there's different things that you can see. If a gentleman's standing urinating, and when the urine hits the toilet, there's a lot of foaming involved, a lot of sudsy foaming involved, that could literally mean that there's a lot of protein in the urine. And of course, if there's protein in the urine, what does that mean? They're digesting their own cells. Something's gone wrong. So these are things that you can kind of see. Confusion, combativeness, we talked about that. Defense mechanisms. We all have defense mechanisms. Unconscious behaviors used to release tension or to help us cope basically with stress. Now, some of us, our defense mechanisms are pretty controlled. Some of us, our defense mechanisms are not very well controlled. The elderly may have a defense mechanism called a catastrophic reaction, in which they just scream and holler and scream and stuff like that. Or their defense mechanism may be to isolate themselves and also are just about get like a cocoon, where they just shut everything off. You know, and people have different defense mechanisms. Depression, a lot of elderly go into depression because of what basically they are facing. I don't know if you've read some of the works of Dr. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, but she came up with 5 stages of death and dying. And it's basically denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance. Now, these 5 steps are not written in stone, okay? But this is a general statement. And basically how this goes is this. Say a person goes to the doctor for a regular physical, chest x-ray, and blood work. A couple days later, the doctor's office calls him back and says, we need you to come back in because we need to take another chest x-ray, we need to do some more blood work. Well, why? Well, we just need to. No, you're gonna tell me why. So the doctor calls and says, well, I think on the chest x-ray I saw some lung cancer, so what I'd like to do is take some more views. More than likely, what this person is going to do is the first thing they're going to go into is denial. No, 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 it wasn't me. You read the chest x-ray wrong. You put somebody else's name on my chest x-ray. You know, no, 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 you did something wrong. When I was being rushed to Kansas City for my open heart surgery, the paramedic in the back with me was a good friend. He looked down and said, Bob, your lip is bleeding. What's going on? I was literally biting my lip. I was convinced I was in a bad dream. This was all a bad nightmare. And I was biting my lip so hard I made it start bleeding really bad. I was trying to wake myself up. That was denial. And that's what basically people will go to. When they get news like this, there's a spot on your chest x-ray or a spot on your kidneys, is go into denial. The next step basically is anger. Now, I did not have time to go into anger because as soon as I got there, man, they zapped me and knocked me out. But if a person does have more time, a lot of times they will get into anger because of what they're gonna miss, plans they have that they're not gonna be able to do now. For various things, they get into anger. Well, I'm kind of wrong here. I did have anger for about a half an hour before they knocked me out. And what my anger was all about is, how are my kids going to make it now without me? I am so stupid, I let this happen to me. And then, like I said, I was out. But a lot of people will get into anger. And if they're in the nursing home, they vent the anger, and you're the ones closest to them. So a really sweet resident may vent their anger on you. The next one is bargaining. This is where this is between usually the patient, the resident, and God, where they say things and make promises and pray that, God, if you'll heal me, I will do such and such. The next step is depression, and that's kind of what we're talking about here, where the person goes into depression. And depression can last during this depression stage. It can be mild to severe. They it can be where they just stop coming to bingo, to where they may actually try to take their own life. You know, one of the things that I warn the medication aid students about is, if you've got a resident and they've gotten this news and you think they've gone into depression, they've never asked for a sleeping pill before, and now all of a sudden they're asking for sleeping pills, make sure they're swallowing it. Make sure that they're swallowing, because they could be what's called cheeking it, putting it over here, and then when the CMA steps out, putting it in a cup and saving to get 20 or 30 to basically take at one time. So depression can be at basically different levels. And then, of course, the last stage is basically acceptance. And when we get into our unit on death and dying, we'll talk more about this. But we do have a lot of residents that are depressed. And here's something I want you to do. I want you to take a piece of scratch paper, and I want you to number it. And this, don't need your name on it. You're not going to turn it in. But just, I want you to number 1 through 10. Okay? Just number 1 through 10. And what I want you to write down is the 10 most important things in your life. Now, it can be things you have. It can be things that you hope to have someday. It can be material things. It can be non-material things. You know, what's important to you? You know, what do you dream about? What do you think about? You know, your goals, your aspirations. And you may not come up with 10, and that's okay. Just write down about it as many as you can. And what we're going to do is, we're in just a minute here, we're going to pretend that we're all the same age and that we're aging together and going through work and different life changes basically together. So write down things, and this is just your list. You're not going to turn them in, you know, or anything like that. And like I said, it can be anything that's important to you. Okay, if you want to keep on writing, that's fine, but I'm just going to start this scenario going. What I want to do is pretend that we're all the same age. I want to pretend that we're all about 20 years old, and what we're doing is we all work in a factory over in Kansas City. We work in a car plant, and what our job is when the cars come down the assembly line, our job is to put the doors on. You know, and it's some kind of a car that has, you know, four doors. So there's somebody on the other side and we're on this side. And as the cars come, like I said, down the assembly line, we hang the doors and get them on as they come by our station. Okay. We start there about 20 years old. Let's just say, for the fun of it, we're making like $20 an hour, okay? We got benefits, we got health insurance, we got profit sharing, We started a retirement plan because we're making 20 bucks an hour. We're putting $25 a paycheck into like a retirement fund because we're thinking, hey, I'm going to retire when I'm 50. I'm going to retire when I'm 48. Now, I'm going to retire after about 20 years. So I'm going to start putting money in some type of a retirement fund. Okay, so time goes by. We've been working there for about 20 years, and now we're about 40 years old. Well, what's going on is our shoulders are getting a little bit stiff. We're getting a little carpal tunnel in our wrist. We don't have the grips in our fingers that we used to do. So what's starting to happen is this. We're not as fast hanging the doors as we used to. And as a matter of fact, we've gotten so slow that sometimes we have to push the red button and stop the entire assembly line. And that stops everybody from working. Why we take extra time to struggle to put the doors on. You know, the people up here that are putting in the windows just gotta stand there. The people back there that are putting on the tires, they just gotta stand there. Everybody stops why we take this extra time to put the doors on. Well, it's happened a couple times last week, and now this week it's happened again. Well, and now today it's happened again. Here comes the foreman. He says, you know, I tell you what, I really like you, but you know, I'm getting yelled at from the guys uptown, up at the bosses, that you're stopping the line and stopping the whole plant. So you can't do that, man. If you do it one more time, I'm gonna fire you. Okay, so you get back to work, the line starts doing, and a couple days go by, you're getting them on there, but one day in particular, it's raining outside, your shoulder's hurting more, and you can't get the door on, so, you gotta hit the red button. Here he comes. I told you, you do it one more time, I'm gonna have to fire you, I have no choice. I gotta fire you. You are fired. What you just suffered was a loss in your life, right? So look at your list, pick up your pen, paper, pencil, scratch something off your list. Okay, now, as you're walking out the door, the foreman catches you and say, hey, I tell you what, like I said earlier, I really like you. I just found out there's a job in maintenance. Now, it's on the night shift. It's not on the day shift, it's on the night shift. You're not going to make as much money, only $12.50 an hour, but at least you'll keep a job, you'll keep your benefits. So you say, sure, I'll take it. So you start working this other job in the plant, okay? Well, like I said, you're not working the day shift anymore, you're working nights, and that's kind of tough, believe me. Well, you come into work one day, And now let's say now we're about, instead of 40 years old, let's say we're about 45 years old. You come into work, and there's a big sign, all employees, mandatory meeting this Saturday evening, 7 o'clock. So you go to it, and you look up on the stage, and wow, the CEO is up there. What he basically says is this: I have an announcement to make. The FBI has been contacting, we've been in contact with the FBI, the accounting firm that we've been using for our retirement fund has somehow through computers stolen all of our money. It's all gone. You just suffered another loss. Scratch something else off your list. Because you know, you're 45. What did I say at the very beginning? You were going to retire at 50 or 48, you know? And now, boom, that dream is gone because you got nothing. You have nothing in savings. It's just like you're 15 years old again. You got nothing in the bank. you know, but you're not 15, you're 45 or 46. So life goes on, and let's just say you live outside of Paola here, and you live on a farm, about 200, 300 acres. It's the very farm that you grew up on. And not only you grew up on it, your dad grew up on it, and not only your dad, but your grandpa. So this farm's been in your family for, let's just say, four generations, right? Okay, so you're working, you know, and you come back to work one day, and basically, here's another sign. You know, let's say like you're now about 60, 61 years of age, okay? Because you had to keep on working because you lost your savings, so you got to pay the bills. You basically come back into work, and here's another sign. Mandatory meeting 7:30 in this area. Everybody come. Well, this time when you go in there, it's just not the CEO. It's the CEO and the entire board of directors. And what they basically tell you is, okay, the car production is down, and we're not selling cars, so we're going to have to move the plant. We're going to move this plant from Kansas City to either Albuquerque, New Mexico. So you have one or two choices: take an early retirement at 61, or move to Albuquerque. Well, okay, let's just say you've got one son. And if you're in your 60s, your son's in their 40s. And he owns a construction company, builds houses. And your son, they have two children. And if they're 20, they'd be about 40. And let's just say they had children later in life. And their children are younger, okay? And you're thinking, I don't want to move to Albuquerque. I'll never see him again. And I want to watch my grandkids grow up. I want to watch them play sports. I want to watch them graduate high school. I want to be there for their birthdays and you know, different stuff. And I want to watch this. And so I'm not moving to Albuquerque. I'm going to take the early retirement, $25,000 early severance pay, and I'm going to retire. I'm 61. Hey, I'll be okay for 4 years. I'll be on Medicare in just four more short years. But still, you've lost your job. You suffered another loss in your life. So scratch something else off your list. Okay, now you get to about age 63 or 64. And before you're on Medicare, you have a heart attack. You get rushed over here to Miami County Hospital. They life flight you up to Olathe. And you have a cardiac cath and a stent done. You don't need the open heart surgery, but you have a cardiac cath.